Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Cold Justice by Vish Dhamija, narrated by Keval Shah. The Battle of JHELUM, 326 BC. The Battle of JHELUM was fought between King Porus of the Porva Kingdom in the northwest Indian subcontinent and King Alexander on the banks of the river JHELUM. The Greek emperor defeated Porus and made him a prisoner. Legend has it that when Alexander asked Porus how he wished to be treated, the captive king proudly replied,
"Treat me as a king would treat another king."
Impressed, Alexander indeed treated him like a king, letting him retain his land. Part 1. The Crime. There are crimes of passion and there are crimes of logic. The boundary between them is not defined. Albert Camus, 1913-1960, French philosopher, journalist, author. Chapter 1. 1.
7 missed calls. Akash Hingorani was woken up by the hard jolt as the aircraft wheels thudded on the tarmac. Still groggy, he glanced at his watch. British Airways flight BA-256 was bang on time. It had taken off after a slight delay from New Delhi's Indira Gandhi International Airport at 11:05 hours and was now taxiing towards Terminal 5 at Heathrow at 15:20 hours. He pursed his lips, stretched and rubbed his eyes as he gazed out. London in January was exactly as per the textbook. The weather outside was wet and cold, and it was already getting dark. The UK had never been his chosen destination for a vacation at this time of the year, but he had been invited to speak at a college in Cambridge. For whatever reason, he had accepted the invite back in October. He failed to recollect. But that was then, and he was here now. They announced that the passengers could switch on their mobile phones, but since Akash wasn't expecting any calls, he decided to keep his phone switched off in his pocket. Who'd call him? It had been barely 9 hours since he left Delhi, and it was past the office hours in India. His hosts, here in the United Kingdom, had told him they'd arranged for his pickup and the commute from London to Cambridge, so the driver didn't need to call him. One Mr. Brown would be paging for Akash Hingorani when he exited security. T5 was an exclusive terminal for BA flights and connected to the immigration concourse through a shuttle. It was in the shuttle that he switched on his mobile phone and everything changed. And there were missed calls. 7. Missed calls. 7 missed calls from the same person? From Judge Shilpa Singh? He called his voicemail and heard her last message first.
"Where are you? I've been calling you non-stop. It's really urgent. Call me back as soon as you get my message. I need you."
He listened to all 7 of the voicemails she had left on his phone, each an encore of the other.
"I need to speak to you."
Shilpa Singh wouldn't have called him if it weren't something grave. And she didn't sound like she needed him to attend a black tie event with her. If anything, her voice was shriller than usual, like she was in some kind of trouble. Anxious, scared, angry? He couldn't decipher. But it had to be crucial. If she'd called 7 times in the span of an hour, the time of missed calls
were all within a difference of minutes of each other, a few hours after his flight had taken off from IGI, New Delhi. What could be so pressing? He wanted to call back immediately, but he reckoned the background noise in the shuttle would be too much for him to have any comprehensible conversation. And anyway, it had been more than a few hours since the last call. Whatever emergency there might have been would have settled if she hadn't called after 16:30 India time. The business class queue at immigration was shorter too, and it clearly stated that passengers should refrain from using mobile phones while talking to officers at the desk. So he spent another 15 minutes worrying himself sick until he got to the other side and pressed call at the last missed call. Judge Shilpa Singh's phone went straight to her voicemail.
Hello, Judge. This is Akash returning your calls. Apologies. I missed your calls since I was on a flight and couldn't call back earlier. But give me a call whenever you have a moment, please, he said, and cancelled the call.
He looked at his watch again. It was 10 minutes past 4 p.m. in London, which meant it was 9:40 at night in Delhi. She couldn't have gone to sleep. Then it occurred to him that her phone hadn't rung at all, which indicated it might have been switched off. She wasn't the sort of person who switched off their mobile phone. Who switched off their phone these days anyway? And she had a child who resided in a hostel. Parents with children in boarding schools never switched off their phones. It could be out of juice and maybe she had forgotten to put it on charge. It could be an explanation, but it didn't convince him. For her to be desperate enough to call him. Him. 7 times. She wouldn't just let her phone battery run dry and not bother to charge it. No, something didn't sit right. He called again as he waited at the carousel, waiting for his bag. Same result. Was there any sense in leaving yet another message for her? She would get the first voicemail, and she would be able to see his missed calls whenever she switched on her phone. And she'd know he'd called. He called once more as he eventually picked up his bag after a 20-minute wait. It went straight to voicemail yet again. Think, Akash. Was she okay? Maybe she had had an accident and had been taken into some hospital for surgery? But why would she call him? She'd call the ambulance service. He failed to work out what could have been so serious as he walked out of the exit. There he spotted the driver, Mr. Brown, paging him. A rotund English gent in his 50s, clean-shaven and wearing a dark suit. His red face demonstrated that he enjoyed beer more than he should. Akash waved and he smiled back in acknowledgement.
Good afternoon and welcome to England, Mr. Hingorani, he said as he took the bag from Akash. Good afternoon, Mr. Brown, Akash responded. And please, call me Akash. Mr. Hingorani makes me feel old. You're a young lad, Akash. Mr. Brown chuckled. I'm Jim, by the way.
Jim, I need to make an urgent call before we leave. Why don't you pick up coffees while I make this call, please? And then we can be on our way. Is that okay?
It's fine by me. It's a 2-hour drive, give or take, so even if we leave here by 5, we should be fine. Anyway, it can't get any darker.
He chuckled again and walked toward a Costa concession within the terminal. Akash followed. He put on his earphones and called again. No response. It was getting late in Delhi. Maybe he'd speak to her first thing tomorrow morning? Should he be worried? Well, there was only one way to find out. He scrolled through his contacts and called his friend back in Delhi. Vansh Diwan. Vansh, like Akash, was a defence lawyer too. Vansh was pedigreed. He was a third-generation lawyer and headed a large legal firm called Diwan Ikhas. The two had been classmates in law school, along with Vansh's wife, Priti, who was a corporate lawyer, unlike the two men.
Hey, Akash.
Vansh didn't sound sleepy.
How was your flight?
Good, and on time.
You okay? I'm fine, thanks. What about you? Are you missing us already?
Vansh bantered. Then he suddenly became serious.
Is something wrong?
Maybe something in Akash's voice had given away the anxiety that had been building inside him for the past hour or so.
Why would you think something's wrong? You didn't react to my wisecrack like your normal self. That's why.
Well, now that you ask, something doesn't look right. I had 7 missed calls from Judge Shilpa Singh. 7, no less. Asking me to call back urgently. And I've been trying to call her back since the time I landed here. But her phone seems to be switched off. Any idea why she'd be calling me?
For old time's sake,
Vansh jested. He was one of the few people in legal circles who knew Akash had dated the judge a while back. Not an ideal scenario, but there you go.
Touché.
But, my dear friend, we haven't spoken to each other in 9 months now.
Maybe she's called to tell you that you're the father of the child she's just delivered. The timing seems correct. If it's been 9 months, a tiny little Hingorani...
Vansh, I'm serious.
Oh, okay. I haven't heard anything. But to be honest, I haven't stepped out of my office since the afternoon. I'm still at my desk working on the big case I mentioned to you last week. So if something has actually happened, I would have missed it. Tell you what, why don't you give me 10 minutes? I'll make some calls and get back to you. How does that sound?
Yeah. Call me as soon as you can with whatever you can find out, or could you send someone to our house, please?
Will do. Give me 10 minutes.
Akash walked to Costa and was paying for coffees when Vansh called back. In the end, it had taken Vansh under 5 minutes and a single call. Hold on a minute, Akash said and walked away from the till, letting Jim stay back to collect the coffees.
She's been arrested.
Who's been arrested?
Judge Shilpa Singh. Who else would I be talking about?
You're shitting me. She's a sitting judge. How could she be arrested?
For your information, there is no statute in India that a judge cannot be arrested.
Vansh, please. What's happened to Shilpa?
She was arrested on a murder charge this afternoon. Homicide in the first degree.
What the fuck?
Akash realized his voice had gone up a few decibels, and with his use of unparliamentary language at the crowded airport terminal, he could sense that people around had turned to look at him.
Vansh, please leave everything you're doing and find out more about what happened right now. Please.
I'm sure there must have been some kind of mix-up.
Vansh, no one arrests a sitting judge on a murder charge because of a misunderstanding. It's got to be something grave. I'm coming back. I'll call you again as soon as I get a ticket on the return flight. Please get her out. Post bail, call in your chips, whatever it takes. Could you do that for me, please?
The anxiety was building up. Calm down, Akash. I've texted a few of my staff and woken them up. I'll find out where is she and we shall get her out in no time. Don't worry. I'm here. And I shall take care of this.
Thanks, buddy. I owe you one.
Thank me later. Just stay cool, okay?
Okay, my friend.
2.
Should we leave now?
Jim Brown walked up holding 2 deep red Costa cups. Costa claimed their cups were 100% recycled.
Really? What if those cups weren't disposed of correctly?
Everybody lied, Akash thought. But let it go. There's been an emergency back home. Akash took a sip.
I need to return immediately.
You mean back to Delhi?
Unfortunately, yes.
I'm so sorry to hear. Please, let me know if I can help in any way.
Where's departures?
Come, follow me.
They took the elevator to the departure lounge.
May I help you?
The lady behind the BA counter asked.
I'd like to leave for New Delhi today, right now. As soon as possible, please.
Do you have a ticket?
Yes, but it's for Friday evening.
And it's only Monday today. Let me check.
Akash passed the printout to her. She looked at it, typed in something into her computer, then...
There are seats in business class on the flight that leaves at 18:55 hours and gets into New Delhi at 08:50 hours.
Red flipping eye.
But you have to leave for security right away.
Put me on it, please. It's an emergency.
There's a charge of...
Akash took out his American Express and handed it to her.
Will that be all, sir?
Asked Jim.
I'm sorry to have troubled you.
It's no trouble, Akash. No trouble at all. I live in London, and my company will charge the clients who sent me, so no worries. And thanks for the coffee.
Akash took out whatever pounds he had, deciphering what was what, and handed a tenner to Jim, who thanked him and left. 3. Akash cleared security at 17:40. He was among the first to board the flight at 18:25. Also the first to finish the welcome champagne before the doors closed. He tried calling Vansh a few times, but his friend's phone had been busy. He must be making calls, Akash reckoned. He called his contact at Cambridge and explained he'd had to return due to an emergency. The host sounded that he appreciated the circumstances and wished him luck.
Hope all goes well. Keep us updated, he said.
18:55, flight BA257 started taxiing on the runway. There was traffic, and their aircraft was third in the queue. The flight was finally airborne at 19:22. So much for a round trip to London, Akash winced. There were over 31 million seconds in a single year. If the angels of death or shocking news like this one could come by any second, there were over 31 million occasions of any of those occurrences in any given single year alone. Simple maths. But it had to happen while he was entombed on a long flight, disconnected from the rest of the world, just when Judge Shilpa Singh had needed him. C'est la vie. Chapter 2. 1.
What can I get you, Mr. Hingorani?
Peace of mind.
How about some reflexology to unwind my jangling nerves? Or anything else that could put me to sleep?
Which single malts do you have? He asked.
We only have Glenfiddich and Glenlivet, sir.
Glenlivet, please.
Water or soda?
Just ice.
Okay, sir.
A minute later, she handed him a glass. Another glass full of ice and two miniature bottles of Glenlivet. Amusing, he thought. In the economy class, most airlines only ever gave passengers one bottle at a time. But if you could afford business class, it was taken as some kind of a confirmation that you could handle more alcohol. Ironical. As he upended his second drink, his thoughts segued back to Judge Shilpa Singh and whatever might have happened to her. How could she have been arrested? What kind of screw-up could make the police arrest a district court judge on a homicide charge? And who had she murdered? He rang for assistance and asked for another drink when the stewardess came to help. Two more Glenlivet miniatures arrived along with another cup of ice.
Thank you, he said. Could I have some water too, please?
Yes, of course. I'm sorry. I thought you didn't ask for it the last time around, so I'll be back in a minute.
Akash figured that if he kept drinking whiskey on the rocks, it would go straight to his head. He wanted to be clear-headed when his flight landed in New Delhi in the morning.
Here you go, and here's the menu for dinner. I'll leave it here and come back later. Anything else?
That will be all, thank you. She switched off the call button and retreated behind the curtain. They had broken up 9 months back, Shilpa and he hadn't even caught a glimpse of her in the courts for the past 3 or 4 months. Did she miss him? Better question, and which he didn't wish to answer, was, did he miss her? Memories could be a blessing. They could also be a curse. They kissed like an angel. They punched like a heavyweight. They could be a sweetheart or they could be a bitch. As the whiskey calmed his nerves, the sweet reminiscences of the yesterdays overtook his mind. They started sublimely, but quickly turned cinematically clear. In Technicolor and in CinemaScope. 2. Akash had never seen Judge Shilpa Singh before he had walked into her court, when he was defending his friend's employee on a falsely brought up murder charge. He had won the trial, but he had asked his friend, Vansh Diwan, if a lawyer dating a judge was any kind of violation of the law the forefathers of the nation had put together. Of course not. Not legally, at least. But there were bound to be repercussions if the media caught the scent. And the media invariably unearthed which leaks to sniff out. Exactly like a pig trained to hunt truffle. When it worked to their advantage. It would be the newsflash that the tabloids lived and breathed for. A criminal defense lawyer dating a judge. So, although there were no laid-down rules to prevent the two legal brains courting, it was an unwritten no-no. Anyway, it was just a thought, wicked one at that, and nothing would ever come out of it, Akash knew. But life was anything but simple. If you spotted a new word and looked it up, invariably the said word appeared more than often in any text you read thereafter, in the coming days and weeks. Likewise, if you saw or met a new person, there was always a high probability of just bumping into them again soon after, and again, and then again. Right after the case where Akash Hingorani had won in the court of Judge Shilpa Singh, there was a get-together of who's who from Delhi's legal world at Gymkhana. Vansh and Akash both attended the event, and so did Judge Shilpa Singh. "She's pretty," Akash whispered to his friend.
"She's also a judge, and not some random judge in some alien town. She is one of the judges in whose court you regularly represent clients. She's an umpire in your own playing field, Akash."
Vansh sounded serious. He was a 6-foot-tall man, trim with salt-and-pepper hair. His disposition was generally unsmiling, unless he was inebriated. But on this occasion, he sounded even more determined. Like a headmaster, admonishing a recalcitrant student. "And your point is?
Are you crazy? I mean, of course, she's pretty dazzling. But don't be stupid."
Vansh's words were an indication that it was something Akash shouldn't pursue. But Shilpa Singh wore a dark grey sari with pink borders, chiffon. It clung to her body like a second skin. She was shapely, wore her subdued makeup, a light pink lipstick that appeared to come as a compliment from whoever had woven the sari border. Her shoulder-length dark espresso hair fell straight down to her shoulders. Salon dried, of course. She had definitely made an effort to exude that casual glam look. Casual never just happened, Akash smiled. He couldn't figure out if she wore vertiginous heels under the sari since she appeared a lot taller than he had imagined, almost as tall as him. In all his previous interactions, she had been sitting. No way to find out how tall she was. Whatever she did, Shilpa Singh always wore her trademark Usha Utup style big round bindi. And yes, it was matching pink this time around. Ignoring his friend's advice, throwing all caution to the wind, Akash Hingorani walked up behind her. "Hello, Judge."
"Oh, hello, Mr. Hingorani."
She returned his smile. "Nice to see you again."
"Better here than in the courtroom, wouldn't you agree?"
she retorted.
Oh, so she had a sense of humor too.
Then some apparently significant son of stupid came by, and she turned to converse with him. Akash turned back to see Vansh shrug.
"Told you so."
But Akash was equally resolute. He pulled out his phone and called Mandeep, his driver. Driving was just one of the chores Mandeep carried out for his employer, loyal like a Saint Bernard. Mandeep didn't just chauffeur Akash Hingorani around. He was like Akash's majordomo. He carried out all the routine and some not-so-routine tasks too.
"Ji, sir."
"Mandeep, I need a packet of India Kings. Can you get me one quickly?"
If Mandeep thought it was weird, he didn't say it. Akash Hingorani wasn't a smoker. In fact, he had never smoked. Except for a few careless drags at some party or a casual cigar at some get-together with old-time friends. But Mandeep wasn't one to question Akash's simple request. Maybe the boss wanted it for someone else. 5 minutes later, Mandeep came to the party hall to deliver the smokes to his boss.
"Thank you, Mandeep. I have another little job for you," Akash whispered, putting his arm around his driver as he walked him out of the party into the gardens. Mandeep had been Akash's driver for over a decade, and Akash could completely trust him.
"Judge Shilpa Singh, I want you to find which car she travelled in. Find her driver, find her car, and then put it out of commission."
"Ji?"
"Find her car without anyone realizing that you are looking for it. I don't care if you have to take the car's engine and drop it in the Yamuna River. Her car shouldn't start when she leaves the party. Even a flat tire would do. Okay?"
"Okay, sir."
Childish? Boy kid stuff. Akash, being conscientious as he was, hadn't given the instructions on the phone. The lawyer in him was acutely aware that Mandeep would be mixing with other drivers out in the club car park. Who knew who had sensitive ears to pick up a conversation from the other end? Calling Mandeep with his arm around the driver's shoulder, it was a tête-à-tête no one else was privy to. Vansh knew how Akash's brain was wired. They had known each other over 2 decades now. He warned Akash again and then left. Priti was waiting at home, he said. 30 minutes later, Akash saw the judge say bye to everyone and leave. He waited 20 seconds and made his exit to find her, standing in the porch, talking to someone on the phone. She wasn't sounding impressed.
"Hello again, Judge," he said as she finished her call.
Then, as she turned towards him,
"Is everything all right?"
"My car. It's got 2 flat tires.
Mandeep had done the job. "That's odd. To have 2 flat tires. I mean, what are the odds? Your driver must have a keen eye to look for all the stray nails on the road, eh?"
"I know."
"We can drop you," he said, as he saw Mandeep drive the gleaming black Jaguar to pick him up.
"Thank you for the offer, but don't bother. I'm sure my driver will fix the car somehow, or I will take a cab."
"It's not a bother at all. And I'm not driving anyway. We'll drop you on the way. Where do you live?" he asked.
"Sucket," he almost blurted out.
"Sucket."
"Come with us. We'll drop you off."
To his surprise, she agreed. She called her driver to get the car fixed and bring it home later,
or leave it, go home, and get it up and running the next day, whichever worked.
That's really nice of you, to drop me home.
Your Honor, it's the least I could do.
Stop it. I'm not a judge here. This is not a court.
She smiled. Okay, Judge.
Shilpa.
Yeah. 3. For their next meeting, Akash did not wait for a coincidence. He called Shilpa on a Saturday morning, told her he was in the area, and asked if she was fine to meet up for a coffee. He mentioned he wanted to discuss a legal technicality, which wasn't pertinent to any case she was involved in. He had expected an excuse on some sort of legal grounds still, or an apology for being busy at the time, but she was delighted when she didn't think it was a problem, and she was free to catch up. They met at a select city walk in Saket. The coffee was good. She liked it black, and so did he. Making up a question on the moronic legal technicality was hardly problematic. She had come in jeans and a fitted shirt. She wore about 3 inches of heels to be the same height as Akash, who considered himself tall, 5'9", which made her 5'6". The bindi was conspicuously missing. Perhaps she only wore it when she met with people from the legal profession? Perhaps only when she wore Indian outfits? However he looked, Shilpa Singh was a remarkably beautiful woman. Fair, slender, high cheekbones with a heart-shaped face, and well-outlined lips. She had dimples when she smiled. Simi Grewal, some 20-30 years ago, he imagined. She had certainly got her hair cut since Akash had seen her in court for the first time. She was genial, not flirtatious, but she gave him her opinion. If she understood that the point of this meeting was coffee, and not the moot question he had posed, she did not show it. At least she didn't show displeasure at his schoolboy tactic. All good. Somehow the discussion segued into discovering good restaurants in Delhi.
Have you been to Dhaba? Asked Akash.
Which Dhaba?
Dhaba being a generic name for roadside eateries around the country. It was an obvious question.
Okay, I won't ruin the suspense. Why don't I take you for dinner to the Dhaba?
She responded with a smile and a nod. 4. He drove to pick her up, without Mandeep, for dinner, at the Dhaba, at Claridge's, on Aurangzeb Road. She wore a knee-length black dress, which, when she sat in the car, hiked up mid-thigh, and he was left agape. The moon shone through threadbare clouds, but it cascaded enough light through the windshield for him to be mesmerized. Her skin shone like porcelain. She was a keeper, he instinctively knew. Shangri-La moment. As he negotiated the car through the choked Delhi traffic, chicken legs at the Dhaba were the last ones on his mind. She was wowed by the decor. Who wouldn't be? It was made to appear roadside, premium roadside, if there was anything like it, and the food and service were, of course, 5-star.
Are you romancing me?
Shilpa suddenly asked, looking over the glass as she sipped her second gin and tonic.
What makes you say that?
Akash was taken aback. He wanted to say yes. He would have said yes if it were someone else. But he didn't know if he should. How would she react? And how would it impact their professional relationship?
That's not the answer to my question, is it?
Isn't the food great?
Nope. That's not the answer to my question either.
Oh, you're a judge, aren't you?
Still not the answer to my question. Let me ask you again. Are you romancing me, Akash?
What does it look like?
Besides being bad manners to respond to a question with another question, it still isn't the answer to my question, Mr. Hingorani.
I'd love to, he softly said.
But?
The waiter arrived with the hors d'oeuvres. Prawns for her, chicken wings for him. And Akash was spared from responding.
5. They met a few more times, acutely aware of the fact that their relationship was akin to matches and gunpowder, knowing that the consequences of the two of them dating was just the kind of fodder the media loved to scavenge on. Totally realizing there was a conflict of interest, they still decided to cross the line. The line that was seldom drawn, but it was always there. Dates were usually at places no one meaningful could recognize them. At Pandara Road, for example. Honest, delicious food without the hoo-ha. No one made them out, which made the evenings even more sublime. For a brief period, Akash felt that someone had fulfilled a sweet promise they had never made. Bliss. Was he impregnated by love? Finally? Chapter 3. 1. The stewardess was back with dinner after a while. Akash had selected lamb chop with sweet potato mash, and a side salad of beetroot, and some other vague, indistinguishable veggies, shredded thinner than rice noodles. But the best part was the bottle of Pinot Noir. 4 whiskies and then a wine was a perfect recipe to induce sleep. He didn't have an appetite, what with all the liquid he'd swallowed, and the news of Shilpa having been arrested, and then no news from Vansh regarding her release. But he consumed all the food nevertheless. He flattened his seat, got under the blanket, and tried to sleep. He needed to be sharp when he got off the flight in the morning. But sleep was a long time coming. Memories flooded back. 2.
I like the sheer secrecy of the whole thing. The shiftiness. The stealth, if you know what I mean. It makes me feel younger. Like I'm in school, having a clandestine affair with my teacher. And no one should know about it. The cliché, stolen kisses are the sweetest, comes to mind. The whole thing has an air of mystery, don't you think? Akash confided about his affair to Priti and Vansh.
Oh, you are falling for the teacher. Mark my words, Vansh highlighted. And which, by the way, cannot be a good thing.
Remind me how old you are again?
Priti Diwan was a batchmate of both Vansh and Akash. The three were the same age, although Priti, having been a corporate legal advisor, had taken a lot less stress than the two men, representing, sometimes, scums in the courtroom. She was petite, 5'4", her skin tone tanned like a Mediterranean woman, and her hair dark auburn, obviously coloured, but stylishly cut in steps to give it more volume. She was a demure, pretty woman in her 40s, who exuded the girl next door image.
Only a year younger than you, gorgeous, Akash retorted.
They sat in Akash's residence in Vasant Vihar. The house was a strange juxtaposition of old and new. The building was an old one, but the carpets were the only things from the bygone days. All the rest was contemporary. The paintings, the decor, and the technology that could dazzle a geek. Akash Hingorani was one of the most sought-after bachelors in town. At 42, he was greying at the sideburns. But the rest of his head was more pepper than salt.
long, straight hair worn back from the forehead. He was sinewy, but that was due to the time he spent at his home gym in the basement. A cleft in his chin, his face perfectly symmetrical, and his charming smile and gentle eyes did the rest. Flamboyant, sharp-witted, theatrical, he was in the right profession, and it was little surprise that he was the most expensive and celebrated defence lawyer in Delhi, maybe even the country. But despite the looks, image, and the wherewithal, he wasn't rutting around. He didn't have a Playboy or Lothario image in the press. Never had. He was, in his own words, happy being single.
"You're nuts,"
Priti rolled her eyes in jest.
"You bet. He's got two, and they are going blue at the moment,"
Vansh jibed.
"There's no future in what you're thinking, my friend," he added. "Now, do you see any of this working out for both of you? How would you represent anyone in her court? Forget that. With your spouse or partner being part of the judicial community, you'll be plagued with accusations of manipulation in the courtroom, day in, day out."
"I'll quit." Akash raised his glass to take a sip of the cognac the three had poured a while back.
"You'll quit what?"
asked Priti.
"Quit practicing law."
"And do what?"
"I think I'll write a book." "You think? So, should I call up HarperCollins and tell them to start saving for an advance? The great Akash Hingorani is about to write the bestseller of the 21st century, the much-awaited sequel, To Kill All Birds, maybe, or A Mockingbird in Love."
Vansh sounded part flippant, part flabbergasted at his friend's revelation. He shook his head like he couldn't believe it.
"I'm serious."
"Why don't you write a graphic novel instead? Maybe with some love scenes with..."
"Shilpa is a beautiful woman. Not just on the surface, but on the inside too. Real love only comes along once in a lifetime. Don't you think so?"
"Do you know how crazy you sound?"
Priti asked.
"Crazy in love."
"How do you even know it is love?"
"You can't define love, but you know when it happens."
"Jai Gurudev."
Vansh folded his hands and let it go. Several such interactions later, Akash eventually introduced Judge Shilpa Singh to his friends. 3.
"I have a man in my life,"
Shilpa told Akash when they woke up together one morning. She occasionally stayed back at his house after long evenings.
"Someone I've never told you about."
Surprised as he was, he also found her admission intriguing.
"Do tell."
"I'm surprised you didn't bother to dig. I've been married previously."
Akash didn't speak. He raised his eyebrows questioningly. He hadn't. He didn't think her past mattered.
"My father was in the army, and I married young. My husband was in the army too. So? Sometimes he moved to non-family locations, and I stayed in Delhi. That's when I enrolled and completed my law degree. Unfortunately..."
Akash could see her eyes moisten, her voice crackle.
"Major Rajendra Singh was posted in Jammu when he and three other members of his battalion were ambushed by some insurgent group late one night as they drove back to the station. The foursome succumbed to the crude bomb thrown at the jeep they were travelling in."
"I'm sorry. I never knew this."
"I'm a war widow."
"So, who's the man in your life now?"
"I have a son."
"Aha. So, why haven't I met him yet?"
She pulled a tissue from the box at the bedside and dabbed her face.
Let me get some coffee. Akash pecked her cheek, tasted the salty residue of the tears she had just wiped, and got out of bed. Over the coffee, she told him about her son, Raghuveer Singh, who studied at Woodstock in Mussoorie. Since she had a demanding job, and there was no one else to look after Raghuveer, it was best to put him in a boarding school, away from Delhi. It was also for security reasons, since what she did sometimes antagonized people who weren't actually ever long-listed candidates for moral awards. Raghuveer was 12, and it was imperative that he and Akash got along for any kind of relationship between Shilpa and him to move forward, she explained. They came as a package, Shilpa was clear. She was a mother first, a judge second, and a woman third, if she were ever forced to prioritize. Not unusual for a single parent to put their child above all else. Akash could appreciate that. He had been a single parent child. We should plan a trip to Mussoorie together. Akash spoke after a brief silence.
We should, but I think I should speak to him first, and not take you there and introduce you as his mother's friend or boyfriend, don't you think?
Wasn't there a Yiddish saying, if you want to make God laugh, tell him your plans? Although they worked rather well together on a personal and physical level, the lovemaking was intense, they had, in the little time they had been together, come to know each other's curves and zones and switches to touch and hit. Shilpa Singh's goodness of her inner being was in stark contrast with Akash's professional life. Quitting the life of a defense advocate and writing a book were great romantic fantasies and good party lines. But the reality on the ground was different. Truth be told, a defense lawyer didn't bother his conscience too much. There had been times Akash had defended serial criminals, people he knew were definitely in the wrong, but he had still gone ahead and done his job. Even the worst people on the planet have the right to a defense advocate. Shilpa Singh's attempt at waking up his inner voice might have been good for him, but it was certainly bad for his profession. A conflict of interest between a defense advocate and a judge were bound to surface at some point, and its ugly head had started to rise. Did she think he represented the vampires? The conversations had started getting slanted.
But you defend those who are guilty, she said.
We're all guilty of something.
What do you mean?
If you saw someone pocketing a stack of stapler pins from your office, would you report it to the authorities? He asked.
No.
And if you saw someone stealing 5 lakh rupees from your office, would you?
Of course.
But they are both thieves. They stole something, so they are both guilty, aren't they? Akash argued.
Oh, please. Don't go philosophical on me. We both know what I mean.
Consequently, the stress unwittingly crept up in the relationship. Both had demanding jobs, and the added pressure of leading a cautious life, that no one should see them together in public, became taxing. The brain was the most powerful part of the human body, and in the end, when the stress took over the mind, the physical relationship started to decline too. Lovemaking became mere sex, a mechanical physical activity. Besides, the tongues had started wagging in and around courtrooms. A judge and advocate romancing was certainly non-conservative, to say the least. And if rumours had started doing the rounds of the courtroom, the media wouldn't be far behind. The two were mature enough to comprehend which way the relationship was headed. They decided to part ways amicably 6 months after their first real date. A short-lived romance. Twice,
Akash had a case in Shilpa Singh's court, but he never made an appearance. He decided to have no dealings with Judge Shilpa Singh in a professional capacity. He didn't want his client to win or lose because of his past with her. Once, he let his junior the courtroom case, and the other case he had passed on to Vansh. 4. Akash was up before the flight was due to land in Indira Gandhi International Airport. He declined the breakfast that was offered. He calculated he had gone to sleep sometime after 11 p.m. UK time, so he'd had 4 hours sleep, possibly less. He was also exhausted from the 17-plus hours of flying in the past 24 hours. The moment they announced that the passengers could switch on their mobile phones, Akash called Vansh, who informed him that the bail had been posted and he was waiting to take Judge Shilpa Singh to his residence at Defence Colony. So, she had spent the night in a police station. In light of what had happened in the past 24 hours, and with her, no doubt, being on the front pages of most newspapers, it was a good choice. The media circus would have indeed started outside her apartment. Since Vansh sounded like he was with people at the time, he couldn't elaborate on the why or what or how.
"We should be home before you,"
Vansh explained before disconnecting. Ordinarily, the defendant charged with a capital offence like homicide couldn't be released on bail if the proof of their guilt was evident or the presumption of guilt was overbearing. With what little info Akash had at the moment, he was certain there had to be an industrial-scale goof-up for the police to have arrested a judge on homicide charges. But these were anything but ordinary circumstances. One didn't come across esteemed members of the judiciary accused of murdering people on the street every day. Out of the aircraft, he rushed to the immigration desk, only to encounter one of the few jovial officers there, just when he wasn't in the mood. The officer looked at the stamp in the passport and looked up at Akash.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.